and Stover mowed it over there. And he said, "Well, I don't know. Maybe there's a lot of lactose intolerance." My mother's living in Silver, and I left for story and song. And she was born in 1921, so you know she was of the big band era. And if you asked her what's the greatest band that ever was, she would say Glenville that quick. Because she and my father fell in love dancing to Spring of Pearls. Now, I grew up in a little town in East Tennessee, and we got a lot of you probably the same way. I mean, I'm preaching to the choir here. You're all my age. Anyway, my mother loved the big bands, right? And she, so we got two television stations in the town we grew up in. And Channel 10 out in Knoxville, Tennessee, had a show at 4 o'clock every day called The Early Show. And they would show those movies that my mother had grown up watching. So if I came home from school and my mom was sitting on the 70 and had a big bowl of popcorn, fresh and pop, sitting on the second kitchen, and she was packing that third kitchen, that meant that I was supposed to come and sit down because one of her treasured big bands was going to be in one of her treasured movies. So I came in one day and she said, "Oh, honey, come here, sit down." She said, "This is a big one. This is a big one. The King of Swing, Mr. Benny Goodman, isn't it?" And I was like, "Okay." So I sat down and she said, "Okay, now watch this. Or get ready. Now I want you to listen and watch this particular song because, now just wait. Okay, now there's going to be an instrument coming up here, and you're going to think it's a xylophone. That's not a xylophone. What it is a vibraphone. Now I want you to tell me what's unusual about this when that comes up." I'm going, "Okay." So I'm sitting there watching, and the camera pans over for the, and it's Lionel Hampton. And I'm like, "It's a black man playing in a white band. I've never seen that in any of the movies." She said, "Yeah. He's like the Jackie Robinson of the music world." She said, "It took a Jewish man from Chicago to have the nerve to do that." And I'm like, "Cool, what?" She said, "Oh, well, it gets better because you're going to get to experience Gene Krupa." And I thought, "Sounds like a hereditary lung disorder." So anyway, I'm sitting there, and all of a sudden I hear, she said, "Sing, sing, sing." And I'm like, "What?" She said, "Sing, sing, sing." Now, I watched enough of her gangster movies to know that Sing Sing was up the river. I thought, "Sing Sing Sing must be like in Toronto or something." But then the camera came on, Gene Krupa, and there he was, a white dinner jacket, beating the heck out of a set of drums and chewing gum and grinning. And I went just immediately went, "That's what I want to do." I mean, what 10-year-old wouldn't want to chew gum and beat on stuff? And my mother was, "What?" I said, "I'm going to be a jazz drummer." Now, folks, East Tennessee was a hotbed of jazz music. So I began to beg my parents to get me a snare drum. I can't get a jazz drum without a snare drum. So on my 13th Christmas, I got up, and there it was, snare drum, stand, sticks, right? So I would come home from school, pull out that little Philco record player out from under the TV, you know, and I put my mother's treasured Glenn Miller records on her, and this torture, you know. And my mother would stand in the kitchen and silently weeping with his child. I wanted him to become a musician, and he's become a drummer. So this goes on for a while, and then I'm watching Morse, and I'm going, "Okay, for my birthday, for my 14th birthday, I want a high hat." And my mother said, "Well, they don't typically wear hats in bands." I said, no, what a high hat is, it's two cymbals on a metal stand with a pedal. And when you stomp that pedal, the cymbal scratch together, she would, "Up." When I came in, we always got our birthday stuff at the supper table, right? So I came in to the supper table looking for my high hat, and it wasn't there. On my plate was a square present about that big and about that thick, and I picked it up and went, "I'm 14, and I got to be a donor." And my mother said, no, okay. Well, you know how 14-year-olds can be, so I just sort of grabbed the paper and ripped it. took that record and just, well, you know, when your record player, when your records and your files that start getting worn, put a quarter on the arm.
Right.
I got that record on Friday. By Sunday night, I had $9.80. I had worn it out. Now, my birthday is in June, so that summer I was working on a dairy farm outside the Mullen County. And every dollar I got went to the furniture store in town because they had a record department. And if it said both ways or Vanguard, it ain't on my name. And I would cut the cell phone off immediately, throw that cover away, put that record on, and sit there and try to figure out how they doing that. One Saturday morning, I asked my mom, I said, "Will you take me to town?" She said, "Well, I've got some errands to run." Yeah, I'll take it. She didn't know about it, but it was Saturday running in the trunk of the car. We drove down to the main street of Morristown, Tennessee, and I said, "Right here, Mom, stop right here." She parked in front of Charlie's pawn shop. And I opened the trunk and carried that snare drum in and walked back out with a K guitar. I set that guitar on the front seat between my mom and me, and she looked down and saw, leaned over and kissed me on the mouth. So then when I would come home from work, I had that guitar on the left, and I was trying to figure out, how are they doing that? How are they doing that? And I did that all summer. And then at the end of August, my mom said, "Come here." I said, "What?" She said, "We're going to change things a little bit." I said, "Why?" She said, "Just listen to me. From now on, every folk album that comes in the house, I love what you're doing, don't get wrong, but every record now that comes in the house before the cellophane comes off, you have to read a book." I said, "Why don't you read the book?" She said, "Oh, I don't know. Maybe it'll come to you sometime." My mother, the person who instilled in me my love for music, the second person was a man named John Stokely. The name Stokely may be familiar if you ever walk down the canned vegetable aisle in a grocery store. So Stokely Van Camp products, beans. Stokely Van Camp beans, all over the side. John Stokely was an heir to the Stokely Bean Farm. They sent him to the University of Tennessee at Knoxville in the 1950s. To study accounting. I get to say this 200 times a year, John Stokely was going to be a bean counter. John Stokely got to the University of Tennessee, and sometime in his freshman year, somebody took him and went, "Look at that." An American literature teacher handed him a copy of Ernest Hemingway's The Old Man and the Sea and said, "Have you read that?" He said, "No." He said, "Tell me what you think of it." John Stokely decided that he was going to teach American literature to high school students rather than count beans. When I became a junior in Morristown High School, John Stokely was my American literature teacher. Now, by then, I've been listening to Bob Dylan, of course, and all those guys, and Buffy St. Marie, Phil Lopes, Tom Paxton, guys and girls that wrote their own songs, and I was trying to figure out how to write songs. And I went to work, and it took me all weekend, but I managed my first song. I had managed to rhyme "Blue Eyes and Your Thighs." Now I had a little fan club by then. This is your folks here, you heard me. But I had a little fan club of freshmen and girls who liked to hear me. If you saw me in high school, this is what I looked like. This was on my back like a school bag is on a grammar school kid now. You know, everywhere I went, this one. So I decided one Friday I would sit on the steps of the high school and have my little fan club at my feet and pour off, you know. And I blew eyes and thighs and we go. And they sit there and do it.
Oh,
man. And behind me, I heard. Sitting on the steps, and I turned around and looked, and two steps above me, I was looking into the toes of two size 16 brown wingtip shoes. And 6 feet and 4 inches above that was John Stokely. And he looked at me and he said, "What in the world is that?" I said, it's the folks on our road. He said, well, it had some elements of a song in it. He said, as a matter of fact, it had a couple of things in it that weren't right. He said, maybe you got some kind of talent for that. He said, if they want to have it. He said, we get report cards every 6 weeks. You've been a little slack in my class. I tell you what, he said, if you will write me an original song every week, and 3:30 on Friday, bring it into my classroom because I'm getting ready to go home for the weekend. And you got the words printed out legibly. You give me the words, you play and sing the song. At the end of every 6 weeks that you do that, I'll raise you one whole grade. Well, you know where I was on Friday. Well, this went on 5 or 6 weeks, and then, of course, teenage boy, one Thursday night, I'm like, damn. Write that song. So I dashed out some piece of crap, and Friday I went in Mr. Stokely's office and I said, here you go. And he took a piece of paper with him. And I said, what? He said, we're going to change things. I said, oh, I'm going to have to rebook it. He said, here's the deal. Okay. Next week, I want you to bring me a song from your favorite songwriter. Who's your favorite songwriter? Well, at that time, it's a guy that later on, the family friend, Tom Paxton. He said, what's your favorite Tom Paxton song? I said, the last thing on my mind. He said, all right, next week, what I want you to do is to have the lyrics printed clean, clear to them so I can read them. And I want you to know the song, and I want you to bring it into my classroom. And I said, wait a minute, I'm the one trying to become a songwriter. What are we going to do with Tom Paxton song? He said, we're going to take it apart and put it back. He said, that motorcycle you ride, he said, when it quits running, who fixes it? And I said, I did. He said, how'd you learn how to do it? I said, well, when I got it, I took it apart. Put it back. John spoke to the man who said, maybe you got a talent for writing a song. Okay, now we're just going to jump ahead for a little bit. When I got out of high school, I didn't go to college. I went straight to the bar with my guitar, because that's the only place I knew where to play music. Where they got music in bars, so I started going to bars and playing songs. And I was writing songs, but when I tried to play one of my songs in the bar, it was like, nah, play Jimmy Buffett. Play Paul Simon, play something with him. So I was writing songs and nobody wanted to hear them. And I played every seafood rest at Merle's Inn in South Carolina. I played every honky tonk from here to Texas. People said the same thing. So I finally decided that if I were going to be a songwriter and make any money out of it, have any sort of chance of being a real songwriter, I had to move. I had to leave East Tennessee. And if you're a professional songwriter, you either live in New York, Los Angeles, or Nashville, Tennessee. With this accent, guess where I'm from? I started to write for a company called New Clarity Music, the Bush, and I was down there on Music Row. I wrote for them a while, and then I got with Cedar with Bush, and then I wound up with a publishing company called Major Bob Music, run by a wonderful man who still runs it, named Bob Dole. Now, he was Major Bob. He was in Tennessee Air National Guard and was a major, and he thought, there you go, I'll be Major Bob. So I wrote for him, and I hadn't written for him very long when I had an epiphany. I discovered that I wasn't cut out to write country songs. And the way I discovered that was one Friday, Bob Bull called me into his office and said, Michael, you're not cut out to write. Songs that mean something to you, and you house on my first recording. Right away, 3 years worth of songs just came out, and I'm like, oh, this is great. What am I going to do with this crap? Nobody wants to hear this. Well, now, there were some friends of mine who just started a band called the Rank Outsiders, and they were writing their own songs and trying to somehow figure out how that would work in the rock and roll world. And they asked me, they knew that I've been to Nashville and done all that music process, and they said, would you come and listen to us and tell us what you think of our songs? And I said, the audience will tell you that, you know, if you're doing this, you're doing good. If you're doing this, you're not, you know. And they said, no, come and sit in with us. And I said, man, I haven't played this long. And well, the bass player, Tom Newman, said, bring your mandolin and just chop chords. And I said, okay. So I met this little girl that worked in my department by the name of Joan Lacey. And Joan and I sort of developed this rapport, and we started talking about our lives, and that lined up. We'd get together for a beer after work about once a week and just talk about her family's from Germany. My family goes all the way back to North Carolina. Falls. I don't know where. And I said to her one Wednesday, we were having a drink. I said, I gotta go. And she said, why are you doing this early? I said, I'm sitting in with a band. And she said, what? I said, I'm sitting in with a band. She said, you play music? I said, well, I used to. She said, where are you playing? I'm going. I said, a little place on 7th, called Bayou Kitchen. I'm playing with a new band down there. So I went to the Bayou Kitchen, and we did a set, and I sat there and tried to follow along on my own and listen to their songs. You know? And right before we took a break, Bill Newman, the guitar player, and the guy that played the band, took his guitar off and handed it to me. He said, here, sing one of the songs you wrote. I said, man, we're in a bar. Nobody wants to hear anything I wrote. He said, come on, we want to hear it. I said, okay. So I took his guitar and I played one of my songs. Everybody clapped sort of a lot. Then Joan was standing up on it. And I went over and sat down with her. She said, did you write that song? And I said, yeah. She said, do you have any more? And I said, about 9,000. And she said, you need to be playing your songs in front of people who want to listen to your songs. And I said, darling, I would love to, but I have no idea who they are or where in the world I'd ever find them. And she said, I don't either. Let's find out together. It was 21 years ago, and last year I did this 200 times because of her.
No.
But you can't believe me and him in the same room without a translator. said, humidity. And I said, humidity? He said, yeah, North Carolina's got the worst humidity in the world. When I folks heard about 36 inches of humidity in his yard. Translator, or you don't have to drink water. So I thought,